All right, there we go. It is good to see all you guys here this morning as we worship together today. What a great time to be able to spend in the presence of God and just honor Him. You know, you've heard Thanksgiving's coming up, right? Mm-hmm. You heard that. Let's just begin now, if you haven't already, to just focus on those things for which we are grateful. That God has provided us with so many good things in our lives. That does not minimize the fact that we have hardships and trials and pains and hurts and appendectomies and all the rest. Doesn't negate that, but in the midst of all of that, His goodness is greater. There. That wasn't the sermon. I'll do that later. That was just extra. But it is good to be here and to be grateful with you this morning is what the point of that all was. Anyway, I just want to welcome you. We're glad that you're here. There are a number of visitors. We're welcome family coming in for the holidays and thankful for that. And we're just glad that you're here with us today to worship together. If you're at home watching this morning, we're thankful that you've joined in too as well. And ask that you'll engage with us as we worship together here right where you're at. All right? So if you would notice in the pew rack in front of you, there's connection cards, opportunity for you to just jot down how answers to prayer that you've seen, praises that you have, prayer requests that you're waiting on God to answer. Jot them down, drop them in the offering box at the back so that we can join you in that prayer and trust God for great things. If you're watching online, on the link that you had that you got from the church, there's a link there where you can go to an electronic connection card and do the same thing. So we encourage you to do that. So you should have seen earlier this week how many shoe boxes were here. Yeah, isn't that a praise the Lord? Amen. I want to say thank you to all those, to Robert, you know, up front. He was the spearhead of all this. And then so many others who helped. Yeah, the Florence might have been involved in that in some way. We're not sure. No, we're sure. Florence definitely was. But this is the count that Robert gave me. From our church family, 389. But I saw you bring a box in today, Robert. Was there more? Sort of, yeah. Okay, we'll go with that. So close to 390 boxes from our church family. Yes. And if you notice the panel truck that was out there this morning, that is packed with over 1,500 shoe boxes going to the distribution center. Last week when we prayed about that, you know, and dedicated the boxes that we had brought in, and our prayers are that God will take those shoe boxes to just the right child. Amen. Do you think He can do that?
Mm-hmm. Amen.
You know, God doesn't work with shotguns. It's like laser focused. Like, oh, that box that you packed is intended for a specific person. Think about that for a minute. We don't know who it is. Samaritan's Purse doesn't know who it is. God does. And He's going to make that work. And we get to be the light of Christ in someone's life. We get to bring joy, the joy of the Lord, into their lives. And so that is worth celebrating. And so we are grateful. And I want to say thank you and continue to pray. Because those boxes, they take a while to get where they're going. But they get there. And just continue to pray that God will bless them. Coming up, a couple other announcements. Coming up tonight at 6 o'clock, we're having a community Thanksgiving service. We're hosting it this year. Over the last 2 years, they weren't holding them because of COVID. But before that, they were just church to church, bouncing around. Well, we get to host one this year. I'm looking for it. Looking forward to that. A number of area churches coming together just to glorify God and give our thanks to Him. So I encourage you to make your plans to be out 6 o'clock tonight. We're going to receive an offering during the service for Tioga County Rural Ministries. If you're not familiar with them, you know, I've only been here a little while, and I'm familiar with them. They do a lot of great things for a lot of people in our area, in our county. And so we're going to bless them with an offering tonight, and not only just a monetary offering, but also on the back of the announcement about, I have it here somewhere, but you have it too. You look it up. on the back of the announcement about the Thanksgiving service is a list of things that they shared with us. These are things that they need for their food bank. And so if you'd like to give an offering of some canned goods or some of the things that are listed on the list, you can bring that tonight. We'll pass that along to them as well. Then also, if you are able and willing, we're going to have a fellowship time afterwards, after the service downstairs in the fellowship hall. And so if you can bring some finger foods. When I say that, you know, what I have in mind is like cookies and fudge. And so if you bring little sandwiches, that's fine too. But, you know, you let the Lord lead you on that, okay? But we'll have that downstairs. And others from other churches are going to bring. So whatever we have, we'll share. If you're able to do that, be sure and bring that with you. It's in the bulletin, but I wanted to mention this out loud so that everybody was aware. On Wednesday evening, Wednesday before Thanksgiving, all the activities at the church are canceled for this week. So spend time with family. Don't forget to spend the time with the Lord as well. I mean, just because we're not here in this place doesn't mean we are not the church. We are the church all the time, wherever we are, each one of us. So worship the Lord Wednesday on your own. Coming up on Friday, the day after Thanksgiving, Red Cross Blood Drive from 1 to 6. If you're able, I encourage you to come and donate blood. Our supplies are again low, and we want to take care of that. Coming up on December 3rd, all these things, I say December, and it's like, oh, that's way out. That's like a week away. December 3rd, a little more than a week, but it'll be here before we know it. So the Tuesday night small group, the Showers small group, is providing babysitting for parents so that they can have a date night. So that'll be from 4 to 8 on the 3rd. Where's Holly at? I know she's there. What do they need to know? All right. Read the announcement and you'll get it. And talk to Holly. Holly's nice to talk to. You'll like that. And while you're standing, walk on up here. Because as we finish up Operation Christmas, shall we move right into another focus that we have during the holidays, which is Angel Tree. And Holly is going to tell us about that.
Absolutely. So we have 36 children that we're servicing for Angel Tree, which is our prison ministry, where we reach out to children in our community whose parents are incarcerated. We have had amazing responses this year so far, and we are looking for gift buyers. So if you see the Christmas tree in the back, we have angel tags on there. And they're quite a bit bigger this year because they actually gave us writing space. It's a beautiful thing. You'll notice that if you've done it in the past, you'll notice that the gift that you are buying is a little more vague. Which gives you fun and excitement, and exactly. Thank you, Dave. We're not locked into what we buy this year. It doesn't have to be absolutely boots, absolutely, you know, a blue blazer. So you can have some fun when Christmas shopping this year. And I would like to thank all of my volunteers for coming in to make these phone calls and for sticking with me in my craziness, because, you know, that's my normal operating. And if you have any questions about any of the gifts or any of the information on there, let me know. And gifts are due December 14th, which is a Wednesday night. So most people are here Wednesday night, so it's easy to drop it off. And then we will hopefully be delivering that Saturday with the men's group, because they're fantastic and I love them because they help me out. So thank you for supporting this for many years, and thank you for supporting the families in our area, because can you imagine not getting presents for Christmas from a parent because they're incarcerated? And one of my favorite things, I'm so excited to not serve this family again ever in my life. We've served them for at least, I've been coordinator for 5 years, and one of the tags says, it's a message from the parent, and it says, I'm so proud of you, you've grown into a wonderful person, and this is the last Christmas I'll spend away from you, which is just like heartwarming to me. So thank you for that, guys.
And just to add to that, if you are willing, able, interested, talk to Holly about helping to deliver gifts. It's a good opportunity for us to just physically, person to person, face to face, say, God loves you too. And so encourage you to look into that as we move forward. Let's take a minute. Would you please stand with me while we pray and talk to our Lord this morning? And then we'll remain standing as we worship in song in just a minute. But let's talk to God first. Precious Lord God, we thank you for the privilege you've given to us to gather in your house with your family in your presence to honor you. That is our desire. We are grateful for the things you have given to us. We are amazed at who you are. And so, Lord, I ask that you would listen to our hearts this morning as we worship. Hear the gratitude. Hear the wonder and the awe. Hear the praise that is in us. Allow it to leak out our mouths from time to time too. And Lord, we'll give you the glory, for you alone are worthy of all the glory and honor and praise. As we ask it in Jesus' name and for his sake, amen. Amen.
Song of harvest home, all is safely gathered in, ere the winter storms begin. God with us joining, ordaining, maintaining his kingdom divine. So from the beginning, the fight we were winning, thou, Lord, was that our sign of all glory be thine. We all do extol thee, the leader triumphant, and pray that thou still our defender wilt be. Let thy congregation escape tribulation, thy name be ever praised, O Lord, make us free. He's given Jesus Christ, his Son. Give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because he's given Jesus Christ, his Son.
Thanks, you can have a seat. Each month, third Sunday of the month, is
Missionary.
Missions Month. That's right, it's Mission Month, Mission Sunday. And so we're excited. One of the things we are called is the Christian and Missionary Alliance. It's very important for us that we take this good news of the gospel around the world, beginning with the person who's right next to us. Our neighbors, our friends, our co-workers. And so our mission is just that, that Jesus has left to us to go, that as we go, we make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe everything that Jesus has commanded us. And here's the promise. He's with us the whole way. He never says, go out there, good luck. He's right with us every step of the way. Praise his name. So we have a short video this morning talking about some of our international workers and what God is doing in the places where they're at. So if we're ready with that upstairs, let's give our attention here.
Something we say a lot is actually our presence is our strategy.
I mean, it's the story of access, you know, little to no access. And as a result, we're seeking to give people the opportunity to choose Christ.
There's one church for every 30,000 people, so you do what you do because you're the only chance they have.
People long for friends, and they long to be loved. In a culture where there's like less than 1% Christians, I think, yeah, somebody's got to go.
There are many people just like us that don't know Jesus and that are lost without him.
They have the half-truth gospel.
A lot of people don't even think that God exists or that they have a soul.
They don't even realize, you know, that it's something that can change their life.
Ministry flows out of relationship, and so we need to be there in order to build relationships.
On the ground, sharing the gospel, and that takes time.
That's what's needed, is people who are willing to put down roots.
And when things get really hard, we can journey with them through that.
It's very important. I mean, it was Jesus's pattern.
That's why we answered the call.
There's not a single time that we've had a conversation with somebody where they haven't come back with, we never knew that following Jesus could be like this. We didn't know that this was even possible. We've never met somebody with a living faith.
They have never heard about what Jesus has done for them. How will they know if nobody goes?
We are thankful for our international workers who are in places where you and I will never get to go. They are present there. And a presence for Christ in a place that desperately needs to know him. And so you say, well, okay, well, our part is this. We pray for them. Come this spring, we'll have one of our international workers come to share with us personally some of the things that are going on. We pray for them. Continue to pray. Don't forget to pray for the work of the Lord that's going on all around the world. And we also give. I'm just going to mention this morning. In a couple weeks, you'll hear more about this. Our Great Commission Fund is what we give to regularly. That supports our international workers and the work that they're doing around the world. And so we receive what is called a faith promise. It's a pledge that we make. It's between you and God. Nobody says, hey, you need to write this check, you know. It's our opportunity to be involved in taking that gospel, the good news of Jesus around the world. So it runs calendar year, our pledge. And so we're going to talk about it in December so that we're ready in January. Some of you, when we had our missions conference earlier this year, you already took care of, filled out your pledge for this coming year, and praise God. I want you to prayerfully consider what you will give in the coming year. This is between you and God. Ask him, Lord, what do you want? And then listen. In the next week or so, Dave Jaros, who's our missions treasurer, will give us some information about where we're at and what we're looking for moving forward. All right? All right, that was a warning for Dave as much as anybody else. But continue to be remembering our international workers in prayer. Let's pray together real quickly right now for them. Gracious Father God, I thank you for those who have given their lives to follow you and have followed you all over the world. In places where we'll never get to see, talking to people whom we'll never get to talk to. I ask, Lord, that their presence there would be a lighthouse shining in the darkness, and that your promise was that if we lift you up, you will draw all men to you. And so, Lord, continue to draw people to you, to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. Lord, as we pray for them, we are reminded of ourselves and the task that you've given to us, that wherever we are present, is where we need to shine our light. And so challenge us, Lord. Enable us, use us to be ambassadors for you right here where we are. And we'll give you the praise and the glory for it always. As we ask it in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. All right. We are ready for our prayer time.
Prayer time. Prayer time. We pray all the time. It really never ends. It's continual. Pray continually. But as we have been all here this morning, being spectators, you know, you see this, you see that, you hear this, you hear that. We participate, of course, in our singing, but we're also now going to participate in praying together. And this is the Lord's Prayer that he gave to us, but we're going to ask that you would come and participate, all of us together. Corporate prayer is important, and it's all through, especially the Old Testament, the Israelites gathered together and prayed all together corporately. I don't know if they had a script that they all prayed from, but Jesus gave us one now, and we are going to do that together. Do we have... should be on the screen exactly what we're going to use, but we're going to say, forgive us our sins instead of debts. I guess that's the only thing. Is it up there? Okay. So let's pray this together. Our Father, who is in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we also forgive those who sin against us. And do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever and ever and ever and ever and ever. Amen. Amen.
We'll do that. All right, at this time, our access group can leave for their meeting this morning. Encourage them as they go to hear and to study God's word together. Also, our children are headed out for a children's church. So we say goodbye, and God bless you. And we ask the same for us. God bless us. I know it's too early to be making Christmas references because it's not Thanksgiving yet. But I think it's appropriate to say, God bless us, everyone, right? Yeah, watch the movie later. Yeah. For the last few weeks, we've been taking a little bit of a closer look at the pattern prayer that Jesus gave his disciples when they asked him, Lord, teach us to pray. We prayed it together here just a moment ago. This was Jesus' response when they said, Lord, teach us to pray. He said, pray like this. And he outlined for us a pattern of what we should be talking to God about in our lives. We defined prayer a couple weeks ago as calling on God to keep his promises to us. And it really is about you and me agreeing with God that when God says, well, I want to do this, and he says it in his word, the promises, many are right there, all of them are right there. And he says, well, I want to do this. And we say, yes, that's what I want too. That's what I want too. We agree with God when we pray. We agree with our God, who is our Father, worthy of all of our honor. And we do that by submitting our time and our talents and our treasures to him, saying, yes, Lord, I'm with you. We agree with our King, who has authority over everything. That's what kings do, right? And our part is to obey, to faithfully follow him in our decisions and our direction each day. As Jesus followers, we're to humbly ask God for our sustenance, our forgiveness, and our guidance, his guidance in our lives. So those are the things we've talked about from this pattern prayer, and I hope that you see them clearly that way as we move forward and as you continue to consider how, Lord, do you want me to pray? Lord, teach me to pray. The pattern prayer ends by saying, "For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen." And we'll get to that ending in just a minute. But I do want to recognize and notice, and you know already, that Thanksgiving Day is this Thursday. And in case you haven't talked with me a lot, or you've just met me, or something like that, you need to know that Thanksgiving is like my favorite holiday ever. I love it. It's my favorite holiday of the year. I love it when family is able to get together, because I love spending time with my kids and my grandkids, and I love spending time with family in Christ. So you count, okay, as family, and I enjoy that. I like turkey and all the fixings, you know. I don't like the little berries in the cranberry sauce. I mean, I'll eat them. Don't misunderstand me, but But I like all those things about Thanksgiving. And I've never met a pie that I didn't like. And if it's not even all that good, you can always put whipped cream on it. That's a win. I like Thanksgiving. But that's not the only, those aren't the only or even the main reasons why I love Thanksgiving. I see that we live in a world that is increasingly becoming selfish. I mean, it's nothing new. It's been happening since the beginning. Don't misunderstand me. But maybe it's just I see it more clearly now. And I see it even in my own life. It's so easy to fall in that pattern. What do I want? What do I like? What can I get? And it's so easy to fall into that trap. To even misconstrue God's generosity and grace in my life. Like James and John's mom did. Remember we talked about that the other week? In James 4, they were asking with the wrong motives. Remember we mentioned that verse as well. It's so easy to see that happening in our world and sometimes even miss that it's happening in our lives. But we need to pay attention to that. The main reason I love Thanksgiving is gratitude. Gratitude for what I've been given. Not what I've earned or deserve or in any way. No, it's not that at all. It's gratitude. And I believe we've flown by Thanksgiving for way too long, just in order to get to Christmas. You know, we just, boom, there it is. Well, Christmas, Christmas, Christmas. And we forget about Thanksgiving. We focus on what we can get more than we focus on the giver, our God. Because every good and perfect gift comes from him, our Father. And so, Thanksgiving is that time when I purposely, I don't want anything to distract me from what is most important, which is giving thanks to God for everything. Gratitude is great, right? I love it. It's such an important part and aspect of our prayer life as well. And that's what we want to talk about a little bit this morning. I think it's the reason that Jesus added these last lines right after he talked about the things that we should ask for, because we talked about that last week. We should ask God to meet our needs. But we notice here that the Lord's Prayer begins and ends with a focus on God, who he is and what he does, as a reminder to us to focus more on God than on the stuff that we need or want in our lives. So I want us to look at this passage that follows the Lord's Prayer this morning in the Sermon on the Mount. We're going to skip ahead to verses 19 to 34 in Matthew chapter 6. If you want to follow along there, you can do that. But I encourage you to look at these, what Jesus followed up with, sort of as an explanation of what he meant by this is how you're supposed to pray. Jesus is teaching us about the practical outworking of his pattern prayer. While we are to ask God to sustain us, the focus, he's saying, should always remain on God. That's where the focus needs to stay. It's so easy for us to focus, to shift when we pray. Because after all, isn't that what we most often think about when we think about prayer? We think, well, what am I going to ask for? I need to ask about this. I need to ask God for this. I need to ask God to do this. That's what we think about, first of all, when we prayed, isn't it? So many times, I'm raising my hand. I'm with you. I'm guilty. I go to prayer when I know there's something I need or something someone else needs. I'll pray for them. But it's still all about what is needed. And even when we're thankful, so many times it's so easy to allow that to just shift in our mind to be thankful for what we've been given instead of being thankful to the giver. Do you see that little shift that happens to me? That's why Jesus talks here about our stuff and how we see it in our lives. Talk about it because I think like this sometimes, sorry. But I think about it as the stuffing of Thanksgiving. It becomes all about the stuff. So if you have your Bible open there in Matthew chapter 6, I'm going to read verses 19 to 24. And listen to what Jesus is telling us about our stuff. Don't store up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moth and rust destroy, where thieves break in and steal. But store up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust destroy, and where thieves don't break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. The eye is the lamp of the body. And if your eye is healthy, your whole body will be full of light. But if your eye is bad, your whole body will be full of darkness. So if the light within you is darkness, how deep is that darkness? No one can serve two masters, since either he will hate the one and love the other, or he'll be devoted to one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and money. You cannot serve both God and stuff. After Jesus told his followers that we should ask our Father for these things, teach us to pray. Okay, pray this way. Ask, Father, sustain us, forgive us, guide us. But here he expands on that thought to show us how we should ask, and it's all about focus. You see, it's not that we're not supposed to ask. No, he said, ask. Do that. But guard your focus. You see, as our Father sustains us, we'll be given treasures, valuables on earth. That's how the material world works. That's the material world that we live in. We touch it, we feel it, we see it, it's there. We need material stuff to live in a material world. And we take so much of that for granted. Be thankful for our clothing. It'd be really cold out there without that, right? Be thankful for our homes. Be thankful for that, all the things that God gives to us. But Jesus here is addressing our attitude toward that stuff. Yes, ask God for your sustenance. But focus on your attitude. He says, don't hoard it. Don't gather up more and more just in case you'll need it sometime. That's evidence that you're not trusting your Father to sustain you. That's evidence that you're trying to take care of yourself. I'll get this together. I'll do this. Do you see where that, how quickly that seeks in there? Jesus said, where your treasure is, that's where your heart will be also. Your affection and therefore your focus will be on your treasure. So it matters what you treasure. Jesus is saying, treasure the giver, not the gift. And then he uses this illustration about the eye, if your eye is good or bad. It has nothing to do with wearing glasses. Just want to let myself and a bunch of the other yous off the hook here. He's not talking about our eyes being bad, like, oh, you need glasses, that's bad. No, it's not it at all. This gets applied to a lot of different things in our lives, and not always rightly so. To understand what Jesus is saying here, you have to take the meaning that he intended from the context of what he said. The best translation of the word good when he's talking about if your eye is good, it is the word single. If your eye is single, if you have a singular purpose, Jesus is talking there about our focus. What we focus on fills our hearts. It fills our attention. It fills our desire. And when we focus on God and his treasure, it's his light that fills us. That should be the goal. And anything other than God and his treasure that we choose to focus on is what Jesus calls here bad, evil, dark. And if we continue with that bad focus, earthly treasure, selfish gain, personal significance, security apart from God, if we continue in that, it will lead to even deeper darkness in our hearts. That's why Jesus then warns that no man can serve two masters. You can't say, I'm following Jesus, and then seek out all the stuff that you need. You can't. You must focus on one or the other. Whom you focus on, the one that you treasure, will rule your heart. For where your treasure is, that's where your heart will be also. So Jesus reminds us to go back to the beginning and the end of the pattern prayer here. Remember, both the beginning and the end focus on God, our Father, our King, the one who's in control, the one that we love. He wants us to remember where we started this whole talk about the Lord's Prayer. Who are you talking to? We're talking to our Father, our King. And that's one of the things that makes Thanksgiving so important to me. It addresses my focus. What am I going to focus on? Because if I'm focusing on stuff, you know what happens a lot of times too? I lose gratitude. Because when I'm focusing on stuff, all of a sudden I notice, well, I don't have that. Well, I don't have that. Hey, wait a minute, why don't I have this? See how that, it's easy to go there. Don't let the stuff of Thanksgiving overshadow gratitude in your life. Jesus is telling us, please, please, keep your focus on the giver, not the gift. Jesus then applies that thought how we live our lives in focus in the next couple verses there in Matthew chapter 6. I'm going to read from verse 25 to 34. Because here's the practical outworking of this thought. Because, he says, therefore, because of these things I just told you, therefore I tell you, don't worry about your life, what you'll eat, what you'll drink, about your body, what you'll wear. Isn't life more than food and the body more than clothing? Consider the birds of the sky. They don't sow or reap or gather into barns, yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Aren't you worth more than they are? Can any of you add one moment to your lifespan by worrying? Actually, the opposite's true. You worry too much, you shorten your life. And why do you worry about clothes? Observe how the wildflowers of the field grow. They don't labor or spin thread. Yet I tell you that not even Solomon in all his splendor was adorned like one of these. If that is how God clothes the grass of the field, which is here today and thrown into the furnace tomorrow, won't he do much more for you? Oh, you of little faith. So don't worry, saying, what will we eat, or what will we drink, or what will we wear? For the Gentiles eagerly seek all these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them. But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be provided for you. Therefore, don't worry about tomorrow, because tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own, to which we say, amen. Here's Jesus' direction for us. Don't worry about it. Don't worry about it. Don't obsess over these things. Don't focus on your life here on the earth. Ask your Father and King to sustain you. He gives two examples. He'll do it, right? He will. Ask your Father, your King, to forgive you when we fail, when we sin. He'll do it, won't he? If we confess our sins, he's faithful and just. He'll forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. It's not about us, it's about him. He's faithful and just. Ask your Father and King to guide you while you live your life through this world. Which direction do I go? What decisions am I supposed to make? Ask him to guide you. He will. Ask him and then trust him to do it. So many times, and when I say this, I'm talking about my own life. The times when I asked God to take care of this or that or the other thing, and then I said, okay, now I'm going to do this. I'll start working on fixing it myself. Guys, we struggle with this, right? Go ahead, nod your head, because you know it's true. We're fixers. Let me fix it. And when we're talking about the things of our life, I can't do it. And so when I ask God to forgive me of this sin, I don't then go out and try to fix it myself. I trust him to forgive me. Now, yes, I trust him then to guide me away from that behavior to good behavior, right? But I follow where he leads. God gives us ample reason to trust him. Just two examples here. Look at the birds and the flowers. These seemingly insignificant, small, perishable creatures, God takes perfect care of them. And his question is the same. Aren't you worth more than they are to me? Don't you think that I care about you more than that? If that's how God, because here Jesus is returning the focus to God, if that's how God clothes the grass of the field, which is here today and thrown in the fire tomorrow, won't he do much more for you? Won't he do much more for you? Shout out, yes. Yes, he will. Yes, he will. So Jesus says, ask your Father, ask your King to sustain you and to forgive you and to guide you. Yes. Ask him because you can't do anything to enduringly provide for yourself in those ways anyway. You can't. But your Heavenly Father, whom we pray to, knows that you need those things. He already knows you need them. So, seek first his kingdom and his righteousness. And all the stuff, he'll take care of that. Do you believe that? Turn the focus to God this Thanksgiving. Focus on the giver more than the gifts. And don't do it just on Thursday. Do it on Thursday. Keep it up. Make it a change in the way you see your life and your world. Your Heavenly Father has promised to sustain you, to forgive you, and to guide you. Ask him to do it and trust him. Pray. Asking him to keep his promise, because he promised he'd do that, right? And then live like you believe that he does. This morning I want for us to close with a season of prayer. We've been talking about prayer, and as Sandy mentioned this morning, it's not just about, oh, you know, someone up front's going to pray for me. No, done praying for you. Come on, pray for yourself. That's not exactly right. I'm not done praying for you. But all of us, as Jesus followers, have been given the privilege to talk to God. And so I want us to do that together, as a body of Christ. And so we're going to enter into a season of prayer together this morning. I'm going to ask that you pray aloud. Okay? Don't be ashamed or embarrassed. You're among friends. Everybody loves you here. Even if you're visiting, we love you too. You don't have to worry about that. There's no standard to reach. All right? We're just in this together. Pray aloud this morning for yourself, for your family, for your church family, all of us, that we would maintain our focus on God this Thanksgiving. I'm going to break it into three parts, kind of lead us through this. And I'm not going to, don't, you're not taking turns praying. Just everybody go ahead and pray. God will sort it out. Don't worry. He can handle that. All right? You can pray loud. You can pray quiet. Just pray. And so we're going to begin by expressing our gratitude. Because we are at Thanksgiving time, right? Express your gratitude to God for the people and things in your lives. Thank your Father who has given you everything that you have. He's given you everything that you have. He has made you everything that you are. It's a gift from him. So thank our Father. So let's just pray this prayer of thanks. Go! confess when we see that our focus is off target. All right? He will forgive when you confess to him. That's his promise. Remember? He said, ask me to forgive you. I'll do it. So I want us to continue our prayers of confession now. This can be either silent or loud, however you want to do it. Nobody's listening to say, oh, I'm going to get the dirt on so-and-so. That's not it at all. We're talking to our Father, our King, and saying, Lord, forgive me. Let's continue that prayer in that vein. Spend some time to pray and ask our Father to guide you, to guide us, guide you, guide your family, guide your church family, guide all of us deeper into an understanding and practice of gratitude this week. We'll get specific with that, all right? Let's just pray and ask God to guide us deeper into our understanding and practice of gratitude this week. While Mike and the worship team come back and get ready to close in a song or two, I'd like for us to just go back one more time to where we started this with the Lord's pattern prayer. Would you stand with me if you're able? And let's pray together once more just how Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who is in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we also forgive those who sin against us. And do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. Let's worship him together.
Power throughout the universe.
sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou art. And when I think that God is love, not sparing, sent him to die, I scarce can take it in that on the cross my burdens gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Thank you, then sings my soul.
Once I sought for him.
himself alone. All in all, forever, Jesus, will I sing. Everything in Jesus, and Jesus, everything. Once it was crying, now it is perfect trust. Once I have salvation, now the uttermost. Once was ceaseless holding, now he holds me fast. Once was constant drifting, now my anchor's cast. All in all, forever, Jesus, will I sing. Everything in Jesus, and Jesus, everything. Once was busy planning, now 'tis trustful prayer. Once 'twas anxious caring, now he has the care. Once 'twas what I wanted, now what Jesus says. Once 'twas constant asking, now 'tis ceaseless praise. All in all, forever, Jesus, will I sing. Everything in Jesus, it was my working, is it and shall be. Once I tried to use him, now he uses me. Once the power I wanted, now the mighty one. Once for self I labored, now for him alone. All in all, forever, Jesus, will I sing. I hoped in Jesus, now I know he's mine. Once my lamps were dying, now they brightly shine. Once for death I waited, now he's coming hail. All my hopes are anchored, safe within the veil. All in all, forever, Jesus, will I sing.
More, definitely more than we deserve. Thank you, Father. Thank you. You are always true to your word. From the beginning in the garden when you said, I'll send your deliverer, don't worry, till today when we know in Christ, you have given us every spiritual blessing in the heavenly realms. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. I ask, Father, that these thoughts from your word, your thoughts, that they would fill our minds and our hearts and change the way we focus and see the world around us. Lord, I pray that through this time, your Spirit would be calling each of us closer to you, deeper into that relationship with Jesus, maybe to begin a relationship with Jesus, so that we can find in you all things. We'll give you the glory and the praise as we see how you do that. Would you help us as church family, Lord, to encourage and support and challenge one another as we walk this journey together? So that as we leave your house today, Lord, and face the remainder of this day and the week that you've set before us, we would know for certain we are not going alone. You are with us. Our family in Christ is with us too. Thank you, Lord, for that gift. We do ask, just as you told us to, that you would keep your promise to sustain us, that you would keep your promise to forgive us when we confess our sins to you, that you would keep your promise to guide us every step of the way. Because we ask these things in the name of Jesus, our Lord, our Savior, for his glory and honor. Amen. Amen. Let's go with God.